metropolitan city of our country, and that was a jury system where within 2 months, 60 days, the judgment was passed. And in matters of rape, they used to castrate the person, and in murder and other things, they used to remove the vein at the right hand and the left hand. So I want your to bring back this law, because even the low higher the bill is not going to help anyway. So it will control. Though the lady could walk in Bombay up to 12 o'clock and nobody dared would point out anything to her or say to her.
You are sure that metropolitan cities of which country? No, we don't have any such law, eye to eye and...
It only went back after Auja and...
Jury system was removed after Tanawaji's case.
Yes, sir.
Okay. When the jury system was there, they were not allowed to take chop the hand and any part of the body for making a mistake.
Not and all. Chop the hand, the vein.
Whatever it is. We are in a more civilized society. Just 1 minute. There's a gentleman standing for the third time there.
Definitions. There are a couple of... I've got a couple of doubts. Section 2E defines a complaint. It's a complaint by any person alleging or making allegations that a public functionary has committed acts of corruption or any other act mentioned in subclause 1 to 4 of clause B of section 2, and also includes a grievance. Now, complaint and grievance have been defined separately. Now, the grievance, definition of grievance, section 2I, it means claim by any person against a public functionary falling under clause Q10 or Q12 of section 2 of the act. So it is restricted only to clause Q10 or 12. Now if you go to clause Q10, it's a whole bulbula here. Clause Q10 says, a person in the service or pay of a local authority, university, statutory body, corporation, society, government, company or other institution as referred to in sub clauses 3 to 10. Again, go back. And the chief minister, minister and MLAs are in subsection 1 and 2. So outside the purview of 3 to 10, which means that a complaint is admissible against the chief minister and MLAs, but a grievance is not. Now what? How do we define, how do we differentiate between what a complaint is and what a grievance is?
See, the inclusion of a particular category of office in a particular subclause does not take away the importance of the word allegation and grievance. Allegation is a different matter altogether. Grievance is another matter. Grievance pertains to a particular person for his legitimate right or duties that the government should have responded to. If they don't do that, you know, you can file a complaint. In grievance, a person who is not really affected by the conduct of the government cannot file it like a pro bono public. He can't. But in the allegation, you can do it, you know. Generally, the allegations are a type of a misconduct where there is a criminality involved or a deliberate this thing. Whereas grievances, you make an application for a driving license. You don't get your driving license. Maybe behind that, there may be many reasons and all. But all you have to do is, I have made an application, let's say driving license requires some subjective test and all. Let us take a ration card or a BPL card or a change of kata, whatever you call it here and all. Some such thing and all, you apply to the competent authority. He doesn't give it within a reasonable time. Then you can make an application to the lokayukta saying that, look here, this is what that particular officer has done. He is authorized to do this and all, he has not done it and all. Therefore, you file a complaint to it and the inquiring authority will look into it, and if it is not it is done deliberately to delay, then he may impose certain punishment in that. There, the criminality part is very, very little as against the allegations and all. Therefore, whether they are there or here, it depends upon their act. If they are all public servants. So long as they are public servants, but that's my understanding of the law. We have entertained complaints against the chief minister. Most probably these are all the same thing which is copied from one act to the other act, you know. We have entertained grievances whether the chief minister comes there or not, you know, within the definition clause. It all depends on the person who is sitting in the chair. It's he who interprets it. There's always, very often a grievance can also be brought as an allegation. Allegation, you see, there's a time limit fixed and all. Grievance, there's no time limit fixed because it's immediately people come and give away this thing. Therefore, I don't think, as Sonaki said, let us have a law first. Huh? Then we'll see how the law functions. Thereafter, we'll get a thing amended in that.
Yes, sir.
I think we had this workshop on the proposed Lokpal bill. It looks like from Advocate Sonak's some comments that proposed Lokpal bill is going to, Lokayukta bill is going to remain proposed Lokayukta bill because it's not going to be the.
Now this is one point. So we are not going to have a Lokayukta bill till the assembly passes it, and there are no chances of the immediate. At the same time, you have made a statement that the attitude of these all MLAs, MLCs is going to change in the next election.
No, I know that.
We should change it, but we will have an opportunity to do that with certain substantial things happening. If this Lokayukta is not going to be in the near future in Goa, how are the Goans going to achieve that one?
I'll tell you. Next time when a man comes to ask for a vote, ask him two questions. Do you know who I am? Then he'll say, oh, you're my voter. I know, that's why I'm here. No, that's not the answer. Say, I'm a citizen of India. It's got much more rights than being a voter. Next, ask him, do you know who you are? He'll say, I'm a candidate. If elected, I'll become your representative. That's not the answer. In Praja Prabhupada, it's Praja who's the problem. I am your boss and you are my sevak. Tell him that straight, that he'll understand that he's a sevak, and if he doesn't do that, next time don't put a note for him. But we are the ones who go by various other consideration when it goes to, comes to polls. Know very well a particular person is an undesirable person, but maybe he belongs to a particular community, a particular group, a particular political party. That's how the Indian voters have voted all these years. And that is why we get people asking questions, who are you? Unelected, unelectable tyrants. Therefore, it is a question that change should be brought by us. They will never change. They have gone there because they have invested money. They have invested huge money and they want their return. I mean, this is the thing. We got to understand in a democracy, it is the citizen who takes the decision through maybe his representative. That representative, when he's elected, we have not given a general power of attorney to go and do everything and anything and forget the person who was given the power. Today, it's the other way around. The moment he is elected, he is somebody different.
Yes, Justice Hegde, good morning.
Good morning.
I'm Bernard D'Souza. See, there are two sides. The bribe givers and the bribe takers. You know, roughly, as you have also said, all those people who are drawing the emoluments in cash and kind falls on the other side of the bribe takers. That is the state. And the members of the civil society forms the bribe givers. Now we are here because we are the one who are agreed. We are the one who don't voluntarily give bribe, but we are forced to give bribes under different circumstances. This is the general thing that is happening. So, on the other side, on TV interviews, you have seen all the politicians, the bureaucrats, are bragging, look, the bribe giver and bribe taker are equally guilty. See, me as a citizen, government does not pay me not to give bribe, to be honest. I have to do it as my obligation. But a bureaucrat, he is a citizen, he has obligation not to take bribe. At the same time, he is governed by the service rule for which he is paid, to be honest. We can't be equally guilty. And therefore, that bribe giver should be excluded. You know, it is not a pleasure for me. He is not guilty. Bribe taker is only given under only service rules they should be tried. Not as a citizen. Because they are double guilty. And they are more seriously guilty because they are drawing remuneration for doing their duty, not to take bribes. Sir, I want to comment, and no citizen, no member of the civil society should be made punished for anything giving bribe, because it's not pleasure, he is doing it out of compulsion. They've got so many uneducated, illiterate, jobless people here. They are made to run from pillar to post. Called after 1 week, then again called. What the, he has no option, give them 100 rupees, 500 rupees and get the work done. Under compulsion it is being done. So I request you that this equally guilty should be removed. The member of the civil society is not at all guilty. It's only the bureaucrats or the state should be guilty.
Yes, may I just explain one thing? First of all, we are discussing the Goa Lokayukta Act and not the Indian Penal Code or the Prevention of Corruption Act. The amendment to the Prevention of Corruption Act in 1988 was made by the Central Parliament, and that issue is not before us. And you also know, you should know, there are different types of bribe givers are there. There is what is called a collusive corruption. The big time corruption like 2G, there the bribe giver was not compelled to give it. He gave something and got something illegal. There are a huge lot of people who are in business today. If you say that the bribe giver is not an offender and not to be punished, all these company officials, corporate officials who are in jail today will not have been in jail. And they would come and give evidence in favor of these government servants who have helped them, and you won't get a conviction for them also. You are only, of course, you are right, in justified the large number of people who are in the lower rung of society, who for small jobs, they give it. But then again they give it, not purely out of harassment, but as a fast money to get the job done early. If you don't get your BPL card in Karnataka, they come and stand before us and we guarantee them in 15 days we'll get the card. Provided you fulfill all the requirement. You are, there are three types of schemes in Karnataka. There is a handicap pension scheme, there is an old age pension scheme, there is a widow's pension scheme. They never get it. The genuine people don't get it. When they come to the Lokayukta Karnataka, our officer accompanies them, if he is a handicapped man, to the hospital to find out the degree of handicap. Takes them to the social welfare department, then to the revenue department to find out whether the annual revenue is now it is below I think 32 rupees as per the planning commission recommendation, not annual day this thing, but, and then they take them to the treasury. So you have an avenue if you want to, and that is the avenue we are trying to create in Goa now, to help that class of people who are being forced or compelled to give bribe, to find a different avenue. That is why, please note, this is not an institution which is there only to punish or get the corrupt punished. No. It is there to oversee good governance. This is the object of the act. If there is a grievance that you are entitled to a BPL card, you are not getting a BPL card, you are not getting your birth certificate, then you can go to this Lokayukta and file your grievance. If the Lokayukta is a functioning Lokayukta, he will get your work done. Therefore, let us not now go in a different direction altogether, that all bribe givers are very innocent people, even though they have given 1,76,000 crores of rupees bribe, or taken advantage from the government to that extent. They are not guilty. No, they are as much guilty. Even today, if you are a true, honest citizen, if you go to the Lokayukta and tell him that Mr. X is demanding 100 rupees bribe to give me a birth certificate, that Lokayukta will lay a trap in which you commit the offense of giving bribe, but you are exempted from prosecution. It's only when you clandestinely give under the table, that's when you become an offender. Let us understand all these intricacies before we say. First of all, this is an amendment to the Prevention of Corruption Act of 1988. That issue doesn't arise in the discussion today. Secondly, that concept that always a poor man who is compelled to pay a bribe is always forced is not correct, and there is no bribe giver who is an offender is also not correct. Just last the lady.
Between now and the 5th of October, when the assembly will go into session, I would like to hear from Satish Sonak what is the civil action he proposes by us citizens to enforce the government to implement the Lokpal Bill of 2003.
Before I answer that question, last month our governor of Goa was either transferred or retired, whatever. One day before he went away from Goa, he gave an
ordinance.
Yeah, he said an ordinance should be passed, and it can be. My question is whether that can be done, because we have no hopes from this assembly 5th October. Nothing will happen. Whether that ordinance can really, the bill can be brought by the ordinance, that would be my question. Answering to the question raised by my sister, earlier there used to be some civil disobedience movements. Perhaps we will start now some civil obedience movement to a proper Lokayukta bill. We will have to set up some kind of parallel Lokayuktas. The people will have to constitute it without waiting for government, which will have some, if we get some clean people like you who are willing to act as our honorary Lokayuktas, that will happen, sir.
So long as the assembly is not in session, if the government makes a recommendation to the governor that an ordinance should be passed, you can bring a bill by ordinance, so long as the assembly is not in session. I really do not know what will be the consequences of assembly having been summoned. I have not studied that. Now 1 month is left. I think ordinance may not be the same, and if you are going to ask for an ordinance, it will be that totally contrary to what you are suggesting. Take it from me. It is better that you can watch all your members how they perform, and in Jan Lokpal core committee meeting 2 weeks back, they started taking a referendum. Unofficial referendum in different parts of India to see what is the opinion of the thing about Jan Lokpal Bill. And once they realize that, I don't know when is the next day, the Goa Assembly elections, it's far away.
February to April.
This is the time. This is the time to make their hot seat, or rather the seat hot. I think talk like, if you don't vote for a proper Jan Lokayukta Act, we will not vote for you.
Here it is impossible. They are coming with bags full of, not only of money.
Will you vote?
I will not vote for those corruptions.
Very good. Then let me tell you one thing. Then if all of you vote, 90% of you go and vote, that 25% who take the money and vote, their vote has no value. In BBMP election, you must go and vote then. The so-called middle class which came down to fight with Anna Hazare, and today you are here before the discussion. You are coming for this. When it comes to going for the voting, no. 44% voting in BBMP elections in Bangalore. 25% which is purchased vote is an outright winner. And he says, he beats his chest and says, I'm your representative. 25%, 75% have not even voted. So we have to make a change. Let me tell you, in 61 years of democracy, if country has failed, it's not only because of the elected representatives, it's because of the encouragement given by the voters. We got to admit that. It's very nice to say, let us throw this assembly out. How do we throw it out? You can't go there physically, lift them and throw them out. No, there's a system to throw them out. And that is available to us.
So there is some good news for you. We have started, at least our NGO and many people from here who are here, we have started having seminars called Voters' Responsibilities and Rights to educate the voters. Because ultimately, when we get the voters' support, the goodies they don't receive and all that, slowly the change will come. It may take time. Now coming back, there's one last, I wanted a clarification because Mr. Khalap also is there. In under Section 13 of Prevention of Corruption Act, there it says abuse of position, they call it pecuniary advantage. And whereas here, in clause 2, that is clause 2B4, it is used as in possession of pecuniary resources of property. Now, my question is why Law Commission had to change that pecuniary resource and advantage? Because abuse of position is advantage and resource is something material. So I feel the way it was there.